voice acting, ups, downs, interesting stories. We won't get too mean or anything.
Gosh, do we have any stories?
I don't think stories.
Well, this will be a really short panel. Riff. That was my professional word.
All right.
Riff. So the first thing is, let's talk with Lex and Sandy. Talk about your how you met, your story. Sit back.
We'll skip a couple of things.
yeah.
The clean version.
Are there children in here?
No, I'm joking.
So go ahead.
Yeah. Okay. So I'll just try to tell the Reader's Digest version of how we met. But Lex was in Northern California with his brother Tom. Here's his brother Tom. He's nice. And they met a friend of mine named Victoria who moved down to LA.
My full name is Walter Alexis Lang. And for the first 20 years of my life, every time I met somebody and said, "Hi, I'm Walter," they'd go, "Oh, you don't look like a Walter." So eventually I switched it to Alexis, in which case most people would shake my hand and say, "Oh, Alexis, that's cool. That's a girl's name, too." And I'd say, "Yes, it is." And they'd go, "Are you Greek?" That was another thing. And then eventually one of my friends, a guy named Richard Epcar, who some of you may know of, he's a voice actor, said, "Lex, come on, let's do this." And I said, "Oh, Lex. Lex Lang. That's got some alliteration to it. It sounds kind of interesting. I do hear like Lex Luthor or Lana Lang, you know, like combined, which I think is very cool because I'm a big Superman fan." But I kept Lex at a certain point in my life. Well, when I met this woman that Sandy was talking about named Victoria, she met me while I was still going by Walter. So she got divorced from her husband up in Northern California and moved down to Southern California and became Sandy's friend. And she said, "You gotta meet this guy Walter because you both do voiceover. He works on the show called the Power Rangers, and you guys will probably hit it off very well." So they called me every week for 6 months trying to get me to go out with them. But as fate would have it, there was always some other event or some other thing happening, and we never got to go out together. It always got canceled. 6 months worth of canceling every week. Sorry.
Our big joke was like, "Where's Waldo? Where's Walter?"
So, independent of each other, we got invited to a very big party in the Hollywood Hills for like a swimsuit calendar or something like that, where there were like 3,000 people at this party. And we did our rounds, and at that time in Hollywood, you know, every single person at this party was dressed in black, because it was cool, you know, including myself. I was, you know, in black something or other. And after walking around for a while, I was tired and I wanted to find a chair. So I was looking around, kind of in between people's legs, going, "Oh, is there a seat there? Is there a seat over here?" And I saw the chair legs, and I was like, "Oh, there's some people." So I parted the sea of black, and sitting in this chair was this real pretty girl, and she was dressed in bright red, like this floral print, like an Asian floral print. And I was like, "Hi, my name is Alexis. What's your name?" And she said, "Sandy." And I said, "Hi, nice to meet you." So we started talking for a while, and ended up going and sitting next to the fireplace. We were holding hands, and I said, "Yeah, I work on this show called Power Rangers." And she stopped in her tracks. She forgot about me, and she was like, "Do you know this guy named Walter?" So well, man. He's so talented and so nice. She caught on very quickly to that. She said, "What are you doing?" And I gave her an old business card that I had that had my whole name, Walter Alexis Lang. And we ran to the phone and called our friend Victoria in Northern California and said, "We met. And that was 17 years ago. And we've been married now for 9 years, but we've been together just over 17 years. So that's our story.
Yeah.
Wow.
I thought it was going to go that, like, you were going to then meet her at the party, and then a few nights later you were actually going to go meet as, like, Walter was going to show up.
I can introduce you to her.
Your story.
Our story. We met in New York. We were both doing a film together. And it was an NYU grad film that we were both cast in, and we both started and were actually love interests in the film, and our very first kiss ever is immortalized on 35 millimeter celluloid somewhere, which we should get.
Yeah.
But we were both crushing on each other during the film, but we were very professional, which is how you do it. And we, you know, didn't you know, ask each other out while we were working. We waited until the film was over.
Wait. We didn't ask each other out. What he's saying is, we were working together, and we didn't know that we liked we. So we were. I was like, oh, this guy's really fun. I bet my boyfriend would like him.
Yeah, I didn't know she was dating somebody, and so I asked her out right after we finished filming.
But I didn't know that it was a date. I thought he was just like, hey, we just were working together. Do you want to go, like, get something to eat? And I was like, yeah, I would love to hang out. You're awesome.
And so we spent that evening on what I thought was sort of a date, and what she clearly thought was us hanging out. And then afterwards, because I wanted to be clear on things, I asked if she was, you know, dating anyone because I'd left. And she goes, oh, yeah, actually, I am. I'm living with a guy, and thanks for dropping me off at our apartment. And I was like, okay, well, at least I know. But we finally, after, like, over the course of a year, we worked that out. And
I moved out.
And we finally got that together. And then we're dating for about 6 months before we did a cross-country trip out from New York to L.A., and somewhere along the way, I proposed, and then we got married in Vegas. So sometimes it happens like that.
Yep.
And we've been in LA ever since. We've been married for a little over 11 years now.
Yeah.
So we're examples of how relationships can stay together, and you can work with your spouse, with your partner, in the entertainment industry, and not kill each other most of the time.
Yeah. Most.
But we'll throw it back.
Well, no, you know, as you talk about that, working together professionally, you each have projects that you are doing as a couple. Mm-hmm. Lex and Sandy are doing your charitable, your H2O, and your work, and then you guys have your project, Children. Can you talk about how you work together as a couple and as business partners, and how... What are the challenges that you face with that?
Well, I will say from our, because obviously I don't know how theirs works. I'm sure theirs works different, but also very similar too. I mean, when you work together with someone, regardless of the partnership, whether you are married or you're just business partners, usually what ends up happening is you realize one person's good at certain things and one person's good at other things. And that's great, because then one person can take care of certain tasks that need doing, but the other person maybe isn't as skilled at, and then you sort of balance it out. And so we quickly realized that I'm very good at project management, and I'm very good at getting things done on time and schedules and organization, and that's definitely my realm. I'm all about lists. I love making Excel spreadsheets, so I do that.
I'm glad she does, because yep. I don't.
And it makes me very happy to not have to talk to people. Not that I don't love people, but he's very good at connecting with people and reaching out to people and sort of bringing people aboard and working with that. And so we sort of balance each other out, because I make sure that technically things are happening and that we're on schedule and the tasks are being accomplished based on a timeline that I've created. And then he sort of goes, oh, we need a camera person and a DP. I'll reach out to people. And so we sort of, for our show, we balance each other out that way. I don't know about how you guys do that.
Yeah, I'd say the same thing. I mean, recognizing what you're good at and allowing that person to do that job in the realm of the project is really important. I think we do that too. Like, Lex is really, well, he's a Renaissance man. He's good at a lot of things, but he's really, really good at the business aspect of it. And then I'm good at, like, the marketing, humanitarian, and we both work together on the creative and design, yeah. The artistic together. Like, we'll even in a press release, he'll write the first one, he'll send it over to me, to my desktop, and I'll look at it and edit it.
Totally do that.
Yeah, and it's the Sandy version, and I send it back to him,
yep.
It's the Sandy Lex version, and,
yep.
And, you know, by the end, we get something really great that serves the whole project, but we do throw that ball back and forth, and that's really important, is to kind of get your personality or your ego out of the way and say, this is what I want and this is what I want, but what's good for the project? What's good for the highest, evolution of the project and the vision? Yeah.
Yeah, and I would say one of the challenges that we encounter, and you can let me know if you guys run into the same thing, is when you work with your partner, with your spouse, you go off, you know, and do your work that you're, you know, working for other people during the day, and then when you come home, and normal people would take a break, and you know, watch TV or you know, go to the movies or get dinner or whatever, it's like coming home to start working again. Because now you've got the projects that you want to get going that nobody else is going to help you with. I didn't mean nobody else like her. I just meant, you know, the projects that we share that, you know, we're not working for somebody else. So
yeah, like, it's, for example, shelf life doesn't happen unless we're doing it. So it's
right.
It's not like, I mean, like, I'm sure the water doesn't do itself. Like, I mean, like, it's a passion.
Yeah.
Like, you want it to happen, but at the same time, if you're not doing it, it doesn't just happen. So that's
so,
why.
So it, can be so it can be exhausting. And stressful at times because you're not giving yourself enough of a break. There's not a clear cut, oh, I'm home. I don't have to be working anymore. Because that's really when a lot of the work starts and we end up working, you know, till midnight and
mm-hmm.
half.
Oh,
Then
you got to get up early for working for other people the next day.
Yeah. And the tricky thing, at least we've noticed, is because I tend to be sort of the business side of things, we found that, like, it's hard because if I'm always saying we have to be on task, then it ends up being a weird sort of dynamic where, like, I'm the taskmaster and he's, like, working for me, and that's also not a very good dynamic, and so you sort of have to go, okay, that's great, my job is to make sure we're on track, but I'm not his mother, I'm not his boss, we're partners.
Thank
and
God.
So even though that my sort of balancing out the business side of things is making sure that we stay on track and okay, if we have an episode due on an episode date, have all the things happen to make sure that it releases and launches on that date, even though that's my job, I also am not his mom. And so I have to, as my job, to say, okay, look, this is my job. I'm going to send the email to you just like I would send to anyone else that I, in the world, was asking to do the work. And when you come home, you can deal with it. I can ask you and say, hey, did that thing get done? But I also don't... I'm not nagging about it. I'm just like, okay, this has to happen, and now you go take care of your stuff. I'm gonna take care of my stuff because there has to be that sort of balance and respect.
We find ourselves in that same situation, and it's a common thread with all entrepreneurs. Most of them have this idea, whether it's a TV show or you know a water project or any kind of business, and they're growing it out of their home, and you really can't get away from it. And you're on a momentum where it's accelerating and you have to keep up with it. And so there's a lot of challenges in when do I put the work away and just take that time for myself or time for my relationship, you know, and when do we stop being business partners and start being husband and wife, you know, like where is that line drawn? Like we have to, you know.
That's one of the challenges that comes with it is determining when that line is drawn. Because if you're busy both as a voice actor and as a business person, that can take 16 hours out of your day, and all of a sudden you've got 10 minutes at the end of the night, where you're like, oh, hi wife, good night, you know. It's very, and then what happens is this, you become out of balance, and then you get on each other's nerves, and just because you're under a lot of stress yourself, and then it becomes a challenge to rebalance things. And we found that, you know, after many years of working together, that all of a sudden we were like at each other's throats, not because we didn't love each other, but just because the stress levels were escalated so high. And we said, you know what, let's create some balance. Let's make it so that we know for sure at a certain point of the night, whether we finish all the tasks or not, we say, okay, it's 9 o'clock now. Let's put things aside, you know, and let's have a couple hours to ourselves and talk as husband and wife. Because sometimes you get so busy, literally, you say goodnight to each other, and that's the husband and wife part of the night.
Right.
Yeah. Or you realize you haven't asked how the other person's day is, because you're like, oh my god, there's 3 phone calls that just came in, I have to deal with this thing. What's your answer, and what are we going to do, and make this decision? And you're like, oh, I didn't even ask you how your day was. How was your day? You're like, you have to make sure you're balancing all those various things. And we found, for us, we also have to schedule vacations.
Yeah.
And even if a vacation means staying home, it's just scheduled so that you know that you're taking a vacation, because unlike somebody that may have a 9-to-5 job and then they leave and they're done, because our lives are our job, our jobs are our lives, we have to actually schedule vacations. Like this weekend is a vacation. Even if we're staying home, it's a vacation weekend so that we're not working, we're on vacation. We tell people we're not here to work, we're
Yeah. What also makes it tough, and I don't want to give people the wrong idea, is that we love our work so much that it's hard to walk away from it, you know, because we do have so much fun, and yet a lot of it is work, and you have to take a break from that.
Yeah.
When's the last time each of you drew the line? Was there a moment where, you know, one of you came home and you guys were working, and the other person went, okay, I'm drawing the line? Have you had that?
I think for us, we started having like health challenges. You know, I mean, just the stress of, you know, trying to keep up with those to-do lists and timelines and, you know, the phone calls. And we just said, wait a minute, we really gotta pull back and, like Lex said, create balance. And we recently started studying meditation. We were doing different forms of meditation, but really this past year and a half, and you feel the stress level cut in half, and you can just approach the day with a very groundedness about you, that things can throw you off, but they're never going to throw you that far off. And that's been really helpful to me personally, and I know Lex too.
Well, I think we'd like to take a page out of your book as far as that's concerned. That's something we've been talking more and more about, and while we have our own, you know, yoga has been our meditation, but I think just some quiet, you know, meditation, I think would help us out a lot. I may have to talk to you about that later.
Yeah.
I can schedule that.
We want to teach it. So, yeah. I mean, we want to share it because it's that effective, and it's just, meditation is just keeping the mind still. So it's just that, all that chatter and all that, it's just allowing the mind to rest and just get out of the way. So, you know, this is not too esoteric, but your soul self can come forward. So your true inner wisdom can really come forward and have a powerful voice in your life. And also those choices, is this choice going to nourish me, or is this going to be destructive in my day-to-day? Is this a nourishing choice? So.
And then as far as the last time we did that, like, I literally physically scheduled us going out of town. Not to this, I mean, like, actually going away, like, for the weekend just to Palm Springs. Because I'm like, you know what, this is going to be a really stressful month. You're doing this, you're going to be doing this, I've got this going on. I'm booking us a hotel out of town, and we have to leave, and then we're not going to be here, because it's really hard when you're in your house to find that sort of downtime. So I drew the line last week, and I was like, we are getting out of town for 2 days, and that's all we're doing.
That's awesome. Okay, so let's talk about the projects that you guys are working on. If we could start with Lex and Sandy. And your major project that you have?
Well, besides being voice actors full-time, we have a natural spring water company called H2OM, and we call it Water with Intention. We put words on the label that encourage people who are drinking. It's a natural spring water. There's not, like, vitamins or other things in it. But it's words on the label that encourage you to have positive thinking as part of your healthy lifestyle. It's just like you go to the gym to work out your muscles. You want to kind of keep positive thoughts in your head to kind of fuel your day. It makes a huge difference. We started the company after a series of synchronistic events led to a really powerful dream, and we started it 8 years ago. 2006, we opened our doors, and it's come a long way. We've partnered with different people, and we've been in 300 stores, and we just partnered with Deepak Chopra to do some work for the planet and to help feed, you know, we have some goals and initiatives to help feed millions of kids. So it's been a really long journey. And then in 2001, Sandy and I started a nonprofit organization called the Love Planet Foundation that teaches children about the benefits of recycling and about awareness for our planet and education for kids and stuff like that. And so we still are very active with both of those. And
And through the Love Planet Foundation, we go into middle schools, mostly middle school kids, and we talk about all kinds of things, not just the environment, but how we are all connected to our environment, how our energy and how we're feeling today has an effect on our planet and the people around us. And so we teach kids, you know, how to be more mindful, not only of, you know, what they take into their life as far as their trash and recycling, but also their emotions and their feelings, and just being more kind and, you know, compassionate to others. And we work with several projects, the Zamburu Project in Africa through our water project. And to date, we've helped supported them in building 60 wells. And that's bringing 60,000 people clean water every day. We work with the founder, Kristen Kaczynski, in that project. And I'm also working with the Hopi and the Navajo, which are very close to here, on their water issues right now. So they need a lot of support to, you know, get rid of coal mining and bring in solar energy and clean passive energy that doesn't harm the earth and the people that are living there. So working on that. And Lex and I also have some TV projects in development, so we'll probably be hearing about those soon. So.
Nice.
Excellent. You guys introduced us to the Sunbird project, actually.
Yeah.
It was that was the first time we had found out about them, and we've kept up with them ever since. So,
oh, cool.
So thank you for that.
They do a walk for water every year where you get sponsored like you would if you're taking a bike ride or a run or something from your friends. And the walk is 4 miles, and it's the average that a woman will walk with a giant jug on her head or her shoulders to find a water hole that sometimes can be contaminated because animals come and they fall in and they can't get out and die in the water. And women have to do this every single day in these little villages. They have to go get water for their little village. And what they do is we walk the distance that they would have to walk each day.
Yeah, and it really affects the women because the women and the young girls are the ones that walk for the water every day. It takes up to 8 hours to go and come back. And so they don't get to go to school and they don't. And when you bring water to a village, it changes everything. They have agriculture, they're selling to other villages, the young girls are going to school and getting an education. So it changed the dynamic of everything in the village. So thank you guys for supporting.
Yeah,
sure. And we formed a production company a while ago because as actors, the production company is called Monkey Kingdom Productions. And that comes from the Monkey King of Asian mythology, originally Chinese mythology, I think, but it's sort of shared among a lot of Asian cultures. The Monkey King is sort of the Loki, if you will, of that sort of mythology, the trickster god who is not, you know, one of the great big and powerful gods, but always ends up sort of beating them at their own game. So we thought that was a good.
He's clever.
He says trickster, and that makes me seem like we're evil. We're not evil.
sometimes we're evil.
You're evil, I'm clever.
Okay. It's just a different spelling. If you rearrange the letters of evil, it spells clever, doesn't it? I'm not good at spelling. But we formed the production company because as actors, as you well know, we don't always get to choose, you know, the projects that we would love to be a part of. We're sort of at the mercy of, you know, we do a thousand auditions and hope to get, you know, a small fraction of that. And we wanted to sort of take some of that power back. It made us feel much more positive about our job and the life we had chosen. So we formed a production company so we could start creating the types of projects that we would want to be a part of. And that has helped out quite a bit, if only just to keep us in the right state of mind. And the project that we've sort of given a lot of our love to recently is a web series called Shelf Life. Because it was your idea.
People that don't know this series, it's a web series comedy about action figures. It started as 4 action figures on a young boy's shelf because when we started it,
18 plus.
Yes, it's definitely an 18 plus. It's not safe for work show.
Definitely not safe.
Not a children's show, but we play action figures in costume, and we're on a little set that is a shelf. So it's very, very scary.
Can you please say your characters' names?
Oh, yes.
They're hilarious.
I play Hero Lass.
Right.
I
play Bug Boy.
Yes. And Travis Willingham plays Hero Man. And Brian Ank, who's an amazing performer, does the physicality and body movement of Samurai Snake. And Dee Bradley Baker, who's a voice actor that we know, who does a lot of creature sounds, does the voice for Samurai Snake.
Yeah, Samurai Snake is kind of like the Chewbacca on the shelf. You don't understand what he's saying, but
you know what he's saying.
You pretty much get what he's saying.
Yeah. So we created Shelf Life, and it actually was an idea that I had, and everybody sort of thinks that's silly because Yuri is the one that collects action figures.
I don't know why I didn't have that one.
I don't know why I had the idea. It just happens. I actually have a lot of ideas. I tend to be very much an idea person.
yeah, as far as how the relationship works, she's the...
I'm like, hey, we're this, let's do this.
And I met Yuri regularly to be on the show, so.
That's right, and we're trying.
It's tricky to find characters that are the right characters for different people. We have a list of things.
I was like, put me on that list. I know it's 100 people in already, but...
It's a good list, though. It's a very good list. And part of it's also, like, storylines, like, where things are going,
Great show. They do a fantastic job. If you haven't seen it, it's on YouTube. You can look it up on YouTube. It's very, very
Yeah, we've got our 43rd episode is coming up on Tuesday. It'll be the season finale of the fourth season.
Season four.
So I recommend marathoning it. The episodes are all really short.
Yes.
How did you get, what were some of the guest actors? Because I saw the episode with Aaron Douglas.
Oh, yeah.
Who was
Aaron.
From Battlestar Galactica.
Yeah.
And he was Canada?
He played Canada Doug.
Yeah.
It was really fun.
Yeah, in a full Mountie costume.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
How did he get involved? Did you contact him?
He's a friend of ours.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. That's actually all of the people that have been on the show are friends of ours. I mean, our list is all just friends of ours. And it's not that we wouldn't want to work with other actors that we don't know. It's just that we know so many talented people that...
And we don't pay real money, so...
Yeah, we have a great Monopoly money stack, though.
We pay in sandwiches.
Very tasty sandwiches. It's really just a matter of, like, working with people that are your friends, that want to come play with you, that are willing to come play with you, that are willing to dress up in Mountie costumes. And... don't mind making fun of themselves.
Yeah, we've you'll see some familiar faces on the show, and Lex and I actually did a and so we know exactly how this works. Lex and I did a movie together that Johnny Yang Bosch, who you may be familiar with at least slightly, he wrote it, right?
Yeah,
he wrote it and starred in it, and he called us. He's like, you know, because he knows that we're game to play, and we went and worked on it. We work a lot for free when it's our friends.
Love like bullets.
It's an action movie. It still hasn't come out yet. I hear that they're still working on it. I mean, that happens a lot.
I hear it's almost done though.
Yeah.
I've heard that. We filmed a documentary / mockumentary about voice actors going to conventions.
We actually shot at Phoenix Comic Con 3 years ago.
3 years ago.
So if you were here 3 years ago, you may be in it.
That's right. That's true. That's true. It's called Con Artists. And so, you know, okay, good. The title.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, it's coming out this summer. We're very, very excited about
it. Yeah, we were hoping to be able to get it, you know, so that you could see it here at Phoenix Comic Con. One thing or other, you know, it always takes longer than you think to finish these.
But Johnny's actually helping us finish editing it, so that's been very exciting.
It's a big
community of people.
Yeah.
We all help each other.
All had these fantasies that all your favorite, you know, voice actors actually know each other and hang out, that's partially true. I'm here to report that's true to a certain extent. We're all so busy that we rarely get to, like, hang out. See each other in passing.
Working
and
hanging out because it's playing.
Yeah, it's
one of the reasons I love to come to cons is because I get to hang out with people that I technically live in the same city.
Yeah, you
know,
see them
but,
more in other cities than you do in LA. It's really
fun. And most of the time when you're doing a voiceover job, you're in a booth by yourself. I always say I work in a padded room and there's voices in my head. But like you're by yourself and you leave your session and you come back. So.
And when I'm walking out, or Yuri's walking out, I'm walking in or something.
Like, hey, you're in. Are you alive? Big hug, exchange of love, and we're on our way.
Any questions? Can we start having some questions from you guys?
Yeah, we want to make sure that you get. You know, if there's anything that you wanted answered, that this panel of lovely people could.
And we're not scary, so you don't have to be afraid. You can put your hand up.
And it doesn't necessarily have to be a question about couples working together.
Yes.
My question is for Lex Lang. You have an extensive music background. Do you that anymore?
I do still do some music. I'm recording an album with a friend of mine right now. And I just released last year some piano music that's very sort of relaxing piano. What I started doing many, many years ago is I'd literally blindfold myself and play and just kind of get out of my own way and just sort of improvise on the piano. And it's very sort of, you know, you could hear it if you were getting a massage or just like relaxing or having dinner with your friends or whatever. And I was some of the pieces, I guess, and Sandy said, you need to release that. That's very relaxing. That's really nice. So I said, okay, you know what? I'm going to do it. So originally I was calling it blind piano, but that's not a really good title.
it sounds like the name of an anime show, actually.
Yeah. Yeah. So it's called First Light, Relaxing Piano Music, or something like that is on my notes. And I have an album called Lex Lang, which is pretty old now, but it's got some fun songs on it, more of a rock and roll type thing. Had a rock and roll career for a little while where I had my hair down to my belt and toured around as a singer and that sort of thing. So those are some tracks from that era.
Thanks. I've actually found that people who have a musical background or, you know, a musical sensibility are good with the dubbing. I think it's all about timing and rhythm and that sort of thing. Mm-hmm.
And also voice matching, because he has such a good musician's ear, and he matches the pitch.
Having an ear, being able to mimic things, comes in handy a lot. A big part of my work is doing celebrity voice matching. So I'll be hired, or most of the time, in fact, almost all of the time, I'll have to come in and audition with a group of 20 or 30 guys who've been brought in to sound like, you know, whoever it is.
Robert Downey Jr.
Robert Downey, yeah. I've done some stuff for Robert Downey, and sometimes I just come in to replace voices that are in a movie, like Iron Man 3. I don't know how many of you have seen it or not, but for those of you who have seen it, there's a scene, it's a very quick scene. Robert Downey Jr. comes out, there's a big crowd of reporters that are outside, and a guy says, hey, when are you going to kill this guy? And he turns around and he's got his phone or whatever, and he grabs the guy's phone and he goes, I'm just saying, or whatever. I don't know if you remember that. And then Downey says some things, throws the phone away, and then takes off in his car. Well, originally, that actor was a stuntman on the movie, and he was from Australia. So originally in the movie, it's like, Sal, when are you going to kill this guy? And he goes, I'm just saying. You know, it's like really, really heavy accent. And the director said, now that's really distracting. I don't want that to be so distracting, so let's replace his voice. So they brought in like six of us, and we all gave it a run. And at the end, he said, okay, let's go ahead, we'll keep Lex's in there. And so if you see the movie, you hear me, and when the guy turns around, he's just saying, we wanted it to be more like standard generic American. So.
I didn't know that. This sounds sort of mercenary, but I will often use cons to visit places that I really want to go. So we end up places like going to, you know, Australia and New Zealand and, you know, England, you know, places that we wouldn't normally either allow ourselves the time to take to go, or, you know, just really feel that we have the money to just, let's just go to Australia. And that's been quite, you know, we've had some great experiences.
Australia.
We went to England for a con, London for a con, and then we, you know, took the opportunity because it was so close to Ireland.
Yeah.
We flew and took like an extra week.
That was so cool.
Yeah,
those
pictures.
Yeah, yeah.
And
you
had to drive on the wrong
side
of the road. Because
it was stick shift.
Oh. Yeah.
And so it's a stick shift car, and Yuri's like, I drove the stick shift. And I was like, okay, well, it's flipped, so I don't know how that's going to go. So
right.
We get into the car, and Yuri's like, yeah, it's not going to be, but the whole car is flipped, so you're doing everything.
I'm used to using stick with this, you know, hand, and all of a sudden it was over here, and I'm driving on the wrong side of the road, and they have really good beer in Ireland. She made sure that I didn't do anything stupid.
I did not have a drink
to
drive, don't worry.
yeah, that was... The first few hours of me driving, I almost got an ulcer. I was like, oh God!
So I don't really know how to drive stick. I think I learned once for an hour, so I understand intellectually the principle, but I don't actually have it down.
Right, you gotta get it in your body.
And I don't know how to do it on the other side anyway, so I'm like, you can do it. Like, I was trying to be like a cheerleader in the car. I'm like, there's no cars, you're good. Like, it was the most ridiculous.
That sounds like my first anime dubbing experience. Like, the beats are going and the numbers are flying by and my script's here and like this what? Paragraph and I'm like, oh my gosh, I have to fit it in the flap. I mean, it was just like, if I was a drummer, I think I would have been better at first.
Right.
But it's technical. I mean, the difference between where you record the script first, and you can add your little laugh or say your line however long, or, you know, however you want to say it, is that in dubbing, you know, you really have to take that script and hope that writer and did a great job with it and just, you know, make it work and still keep the acting in. And then, so it took me a while to get the technical stuff down. And then I forgot the numbers at the bottom. I just said, forget that. I'm just going to trust
the beats.
When
we started, there were no beats before. It was just time code. And so it's 30 frames per second. So you'd see the seconds go by, and then you'd see the frames go by really fast because it's 30 of them each second. So the director would say, okay, a second, at 1 minute, 17 seconds, and 22 frames is when you start, and you end by, 9 seconds and 18 frames. And so, like, that's in your mind, and then you're looking at your own, going, okay, I have to say the line, I have to look up, and I'm watching the numbers, they're going by really fast, and they come here, they go, oh, you know. So it was, like, really nerve-wracking.
I don't know why they don't do it with the lights.
They didn't have lights.
I don't know why they don't do that.
Now they have beeps. For those of you who don't know, basically when we're doing anime, they have three beeps. It goes boop, boop, boop. And on the fourth imaginary beep is when we start our line. And that's when the mouth opens on the cartoon. So that makes it a whole lot less stressful for us, because we go, okay, if you can tap your foot along with the beeps, then on that fourth tap is when you're going to start talking. And if you've got a good writer, like Sandy said, then everything fits. You can just do it sort of naturally, you can act, and everything works. If you have a bad writer, then you have to slow down in certain areas, you have to add little words, and you have to, you know, adjust accordingly. Yeah. And the director usually helps you out with that.
Yeah. Do they edit while you're there? I mean, if you're there and it's just not working, is there a writer there in the room?
The director will say, why don't you add tonight at the end of that, or already, or whatever.
And then also the engineer will stretch or do some things with
it. With Pro Tools now, when we started, it was all on tape.
In a garage. Really?
It was like in some kind of basement somewhere, and we were working on tape. So if it didn't fit, it was like, okay, let's go again. You know, you do 18 takes on something because you were just like an eighth of a second off. Mm-hmm. Now, with Pro Tools, we record it, and they go, oh, it's an eighth of a second short. And they go, don't worry, we'll expand it. And just grab the file, they expand it, it opens up, it still sounds great, and everything works. And so you're like, oh, cool.
Yeah. Now, if we can get it just close enough, I can do the rest. Yeah.
I still don't know why they didn't do the lights, because in Japan they do a light on the screen. It'll have like a little
It pops up like a color bar while you're talking, then goes away when you're supposed to.
So you know that that's when you're supposed to. So that would have been so much easier than just having to read the time code, because that would have driven me crazy too. I would have been like, what about the color? Because I'm counting the numbers.
It was funny because our first session we were in a studio where the microphone was like a normal style mic, and it wasn't grounded properly, so every time, like, if your lip touched it, you could get shot.
That's horrible.
And yet you're still doing it.
It's dangerous. Yes. It is dangerous what we do. Actually, it is. Two days ago, I was in a voiceover session, and this is after 2 days of doing motion capture, which is, you know, stunts and moving around and, you know, things where you should, you know, there's a potential to get hurt. And I didn't get hurt through any of that. And then I walk into a voiceover session and I put some stuff down on the floor over by the side of the room. And then I get up and there was a TV monitor, flat screen TV. And I, you can't see. There's a hole in my head. And I hit it.
It's filled with Neosporin, it's fine.
There were other people in the room, and so I mean, you know, I didn't want to, you know, look like a jackass, and so I hit my head, and they're like, oh, are you okay? I'm like, oh, I'm fine. You know, adrenaline flooding. Flooded with adrenaline.
Literally, it was coming.
And I walked over, and I'm like, no, I'm fine. And then you feel that trickle straight up. Oh, I might not be fine for 1 second. And I grabbed a Kleenex, and one of the other cast members was like, are you okay, man? And I'm like, oh, yeah, I'm fine. So, see, it can be dangerous.
The moral of the story, don't stand up into televisions.
It's really for everyone. Has there ever been a production that your spouse has got to work on that you wish that you were a part of?
Yeah. Because we don't always, you know, despite the fact that we're married and we're both in the same business, you know, there's nothing to say that we're ever going to get cast on the same thing together. But there are shows or things that that you've done that I was like, oh, it would have been great to work on that.
Yeah.
I'm trying to think of specific ones.
Sandy got to work on Wreck-It Ralph.
Oh.
I was supposed to work on it, but that day I was working on a show called Californication. And they were doing 3 or 4 episodes that day, which for us means like 3 or 4 different contracts, which is really good for us if you can get multiples. And so I wasn't able to do it, and I missed doing that so much because I wanted it. It sounded like such a fun session.
And that was in the Walla group, you know, so there was about 27 of us, including the little kids. And, you know, Disney said, bring in all the A-listers, and so that, you know, Jim Cummings, who does Winnie the Pooh, and Jess Arnell, and all these amazing, you know, I was in awe of the talent in the room, Lorraine Newman. And then they said, bring in the highest voice you know. So I think that was where I got in. It was so great because, you know, can you pitch up the, you know, the little candies that were screaming in the stand? So I got to be lots of little candies and popcorn, and so it was just a dream. Because I worked for Disney for 13 years as an entertainer in Orlando, and my first job at age 17 was actually in Mickey Mouse as a walking around Mickey Mouse. So I have a love for Disney. I grew up there, and so when I got to work on the Disney lot, I always wondered how you get to be. You know, Disney movies.
I think we all want to be a character you can hear really well.
Yeah.
And characters got lines and things like that in those Pixar or DreamWorks films.
Yeah.
That's a dream of, I'm sure, all of us.
Yeah.
And a couple of our friends and people we work with in Wreck-It Ralph got to be one of those characters that you really get to hear because they had played the character, you know, in the video game or,
that's right,
you know, before.
Kyle.
And Roger Craig Smith.
Yeah.
I know you guys probably get asked all the time what your favorite voice role has been, so I wanted to mix it up a little bit. What's your favorite voice role that your spouse has done?
Ooh, that's a tricky one. For me, it's going to be between two. I really loved him as Superman in Legion of Superheroes. Because I feel like that's just like, that's him. Like, that's like, I'm like, he's Superman, and that's just him. But I so enjoy his he literally stood like that when he was recording. And he did until somebody brought to his attention that he would stand like that. That's why you're Superman.
I'm so method.
My second is from the Prince of Persia video games, The Prince, because it's so fun to just play him.
It would be hard to not choose Wonder Woman when you did DC versus Mortal Kombat video game, because who doesn't want to be married to Wonder Woman? That's kind of awesome. and it's sort of this sexy, commanding voice that I would never let her use at home in a video game. She always uses it at home. And I always do what she tells me when she says it. So,
we don't have that problem. I can go there. Well, definitely when Lex was cast as Han Solo in the Star Wars game. I mean, it was just, you know, screaming and jumping up, and I was just so happy for him, and just to hear him in that role, I think that was like the big one.
Well, the reason I was screaming and jumping up and down is because many years ago, I came to a Star Trek Star Wars convention at the Hyatt across the street before they were doing Comic-Con here. And I did cosplay, and I was dressed as Han Solo. And it's before I was a voice actor, I was still just acting in high school or theater or whatever. And so when I had the chance to audition to be Han Solo, that was already like thrill number one. And they auditioned 400 people in Los Angeles, 400 in San Francisco, 400 in Chicago, 400 in New York. And it kept boiling down and down and down and down, and we kept having to send in more auditions of ourselves. And at one point, it was down to 8 of us, and they sent us all of Harrison Ford's lines on his CD that didn't have any music or anything. It was all like production of Harrison Ford saying all his lines. And so we studied these for a while. For me, it was like, you know, I'm a Star Wars geek, so for me, it was like, ha-ha, gold. You know, I had all this up, and I started listening and playing it back and back and back. So eventually when my agent called and said, you got Han Solo, I was like a little girl in my house. Like, yeah! That was like the biggest thrill. One of the very biggest thrills.
Yeah. That must have been so nerve-wracking, but so awesome.
Yeah, it was incredible. And I did like 5 or 6 games, and then what happened is a guy who sounds exactly, I mean, doesn't have to do any voice manipulation at all. He sounds just like Harrison Ford, called George Lucas's office, pretending he was Harrison Ford, to try to get on a game. He wanted to be the voice of Han Solo. I mean, he is now the voice of Han Solo. But that's okay. It's just the last year or so he's been doing it. But LucasArts has been very loyal to me for many, many, many years now. And every game they have, I'm like the main stormtrooper. So when you're playing, you got a stormtrooper tagging along, and they say, over here, or whatever, thousands and thousands of lines. That's me also. And if you get the Star Wars pinball for your iPad, your Kindle, if you're really bad at it and the ball drops right away, there's a stormtrooper that goes, move along. that's me. And you can hear more of that. So to answer the question, as far as Sandy's voice, Betty Boop is one of my favorites that she does, because she is so good and she is such a natural.
And it's really interesting because in the 20s there was a group of like a handful of women that did Betty Boop, and over since Mae Questel, who the last job that she did was actually voicing Betty Boop for Roger Rabbit, she passed on. There's been several women that have done Betty Boop's voice, but Betty Boop has always been a thread in my career. When I was 18 years old, I was working nights in a Bennigan's as the hostess that, last call for alcohol, which is kind of funny.
Yeah.
But my voice, and this guy goes, hey, he goes, you sound just like Helen Kane. And Helen Kane was a woman, one of the women who did Betty Boop's voice. He goes, do you sing? And I go, yeah, I do. He goes, will you come audition for my orchestra? I said, sure. So I started singing with this 1920s jazz orchestra for 11 years. We opened for Cab Calloway. I opened for Dizzy Gillespie and Pete Fountain. And I didn't even know I was standing in the presence of these jazz greats. But so I sang the songs of Betty Boop for so many years. And it's actually how she brought me to California, to Los Angeles. I wanted to do voiceover, and I didn't know anybody in LA, and I ended up, so they asked me, can you dress like her? And I got a job at Universal Studios Hollywood as Betty Boop, as a living Betty Boop. And the first 2 years I worked there, I toured Asia and Japan and Europe as a living Betty Boop. And so, did that for a long time, and then was working on The Simpsons at the same time. So it's real. She's been like a little cartoon angel for me, in my career. So last year I got to fly to Paris and dub Betty Boop's voice for a 2-minute film. The DP for the artist, he was the DP on the film, and the director was a comic book artist named Joan Savar, and it was this beautiful, glamorous film. You can see it online if you Google Betty Boop Lancome. Or go to sandyfox.com, it's on the front page. But that was just such an exciting honor to fly to, Paris, my favorite city in the world, and one of them, and to dub Betty Boop. And there was another case of dubbing where you go into the studio and they write the dialogue in beautiful handwriting, and it's scrolling across the screen.
Wow.
And I was like, oh my God.
Why can't there be more
editing
than
editing in Paris? I know.
But it makes me speak French.
That's
right.
True.
Right. Right.
Question. Do you have one over there?
This one's for Lex and Yuri. You voiced Sanzo and Goku in Sayuki Reload.
Yes, we did.
When you were recording that, were you at all familiar with the ADV dub?
The original show? I remember I had heard about it when it was going on. And because we know a lot of actors in Texas, they're like, are you guys doing the dub? Because we already did that show. And I'm like, sorry, I don't know. I just got the job. And I know there was sort of a lot of controversy because there are people who really, love the ADV dub. And then we came in and, revoiced it. Because I think another company bought the rights to it. And so they wanted to go ahead and do their own version. I wasn't as familiar with it when I first started. And it was just a job. This, it happens all the time. But the more I, it went on, the more I heard about it, the more I sort of found out about all that stuff that was going on.
Yeah, I had heard about it. I hadn't seen it before I got cast in it. And when I asked the director, I said, can I see what the other actor did so that I can like keep the continuity between the two programs? I said, absolutely not. You are not allowed. This is our dub of it. And the director was very, very persistent in saying, you do what I want you to do with this character. And you know what? We got our own freedom as actors to do, you know, what we brought to it. But we weren't even allowed, I wasn't allowed to hear the other character. So I heard they did a great job.
Yes, I know that's what always makes it difficult is, you know, when you're replacing or doing another version of something that was already done really well.
Yeah.
You guys did a great job too.
Yeah, well, thank you. Thank you.
Yeah, I was curious. Sandy shared her entrance into voice acting. I was curious about the others. How did you happen to come into voice acting?
Well, for us, we actually came into it together because we were already doing film and television and theater. And when we moved out to Los Angeles, we were just looking for work as actors. I mean, we had to eat and pay rent, you know. And so after the first few months of being in Los Angeles and doing some auditions and doing some TV stuff, we were like, okay, we have to make a living. What are we going to do? What's voiceover? And so we actually got into a class together because we didn't know anything about voice. I mean, we had seen animated movies or cartoons and things like that. I mean, we knew it was something, but we didn't know what it was. We didn't know anyone that did it. And so we actually just got into a class, and from that class, we got demos, and we started auditioning, and that's how Yuri and I sort of fell into it. I mean, he grew up watching
cartoons. I mean, I was kind of embarrassed that I hadn't thought of that sooner, because I grew up, you know, watching anime and cartoons, you know, American cartoons, and playing video games, and I should have thought about that sooner. Like, oh, that's something I can do, but somehow it seemed so far away from the things I was used to with, you know, being on stage or, you know, being in front of the camera. And then luckily, as luck would have it, the guy who taught our class ended up getting a job directing an anime dub. It was for SD Gundam Force, which I know you hardcore Gundam guys out there, you probably ignore the SD, the super deformed Gundams. It's like you know, kids, you know, Gundam for kids. But actually, it was this really great show, and happened to be my very first, you know, dub at all, which is where I started learning this skill and meeting, you know, other people in the community. And so that's how it started for me.
That's cool. I came from a acting background, theater, and I did theater through high school and then through college, and also stand-up comedy. And as part of my stand-up comedy, I would do celebrity impersonations because, you know, we were talking about the ear and being able to, you know, mimic people. So I was mimicking a lot of actors and things. And one night, I was on a movie set with a friend of mine who was in the film, and I was a guest of his on the set, and we all went out to sushi, and we had sushi and mass amounts of sake, and we were walking back to the hotel, and it was in Vancouver, and when we were walking back, I started just doing one impression after the next, and one of the female leads was a girl named Amy Jo Johnson, who was one of the Pink Power Ranger, and she also has been on a lot of other stuff, but she said, you'd be great as a voice actor, and I said, what's voice acting? You mean like I'm doing commercials or something? Because I really, like Yuri, I hadn't really thought of it. It was like, I've watched cartoons my whole life, you know, Mel Blanc and all these people, and I never thought of doing it. And so she introduced me to the producer of the Power Rangers, and I got into their wallop group, which is just all the background voices. So a lot of my first gigs were just running away from monsters screaming. And then I begged to get a speaking part, and I got this character named Louis Kaboom, which didn't say anything but his own name, so he just ran around going, Louis Kaboom! That was all he did. And so I begged again to do more, and I got more. And around that same time, as I was saying in that story earlier how we met, I was working on the Power Rangers, I met Sandy, and Sandy was with an agency called ICM, which is a very big agency, and she introduced me to her agent, and they took me on at ICM. I made it, she helped me get my demo together, and you know, I have much to thank, you know, Sandy to thank for as far as my career, because she kind of helped me put all the pieces in place so that I could start getting out there. And I made a business card that said Celebrity Voice Match Specialist, and I gave it to a lot of the different studios because they need a lot of that and they don't know where to turn. So all of a sudden I was being invited to all these auditions, and once I booked a number of them, then people started knowing that I could do that, and they started calling me. And then I just kind of diversified into narration and animation, and we did some anime together, and yeah,
How does it feel to be with Tara in Ben 10 Omniverse?
It's so much fun. Like I was saying before, we don't always get the opportunity to, you know, to work with our spouse, you know, on the same projects. And so when we do it, it's like a bonus. So having her, you know, on the show, now having played actually two different characters over the incarnation of the show, is awesome. It's great because also that show records, you know, Sandy was saying, most of our recording we do solo. And that's one of the few shows that I work on where they try to record it all as a cast. So we actually get to be in the same room together, acting together, which is like, you know, on the scale of the work we do is up here.
But he actually gets to work with two Taras on that show because he also works with Tara Strong. Yeah, that's who you were talking about.
Yeah,
I know.
Tara Strong.
Oh, sorry.
Okay. I figured out
I made the right choice, though. I assumed he was talking about me. Thank you, sir, for winning points with my helping me to win points. working with Tara Strong is fun too because she's so talented. Like I'm always just like in awe, and I always think that I know sort of. I'm like, okay, so this is what you know Tara Strong does, and then she'll do some you know voice out of left field. I'm like, where'd that come from?
That's like Jamie Turner or
yeah, any of or you know. Yeah, there you go. She's all over the place.
It's funny, you know, Sandy and I did a show called Fist of the North Star.
Oh, yeah.
Where I played Kenjiro, and she played Lin, the little girl he was looking for all the time. Yeah. And so my girl was like, I must find Lin.
And the whole show, all I said was, Ken!
She was looking for each other the whole time.
Well, we are done on our time. I thank you. This was fine. Do you want to do it? Okay, take it all back. We have one more question. One more question over here? Yes.
You know, when you're coming in there, you have a perspective. When you're working at a game, sometimes you don't have one because some of the games don't have concerts. What do you think in your mind?
Oh, video game. A lot of times when we get a video game, we'll be given a script that's a giant stack of about 1,000 lines, and we have to just go through them, often saying them twice each. If we have any questions about the context, we'll just ask the director. We'll say, like, where does this happen in the game? Who's after him at this point? And a lot of times there'll be a little, like a notes section in our script that'll say, like, defending themselves, or going after the villain, or, you know, whatever.
Running and breathing heavy or something.
Yeah. So if we don't have cutscenes that we have to match class for, a lot of times we have the liberty of bringing whatever we want to bring to the part for that.
And they are timed because there's certain like hits, punches, or yells, or you know, death scenes, and they have to be a number of seconds. So the director will tell you, you know, or they'll play if it's a game like a Japanese game, they'll you know play the original hit. And then they'll want you to match the timing of it. You can do whatever you want with it. And they will give you a picture of the character. So I get to see the character, and at least I can look at that character and have an understanding of the energy of that character. Is it evil? You know, is it evil? Is it cute? Is it cute and evil? Most of mine are cute and evil.
But thank you. Come and see if you didn't get your question in, so.
Yes.
Panels, and go see them downstairs.
Sandy has a new book.